together and say,
I confess, O Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary of her Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray. Grant us, Lord, we pray, that being rightly conformed to the Paschal mysteries, what we celebrate in joy may protect and save us with perpetual power. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. The reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The apostles and presbyters, in agreement with the whole church, decided to choose representatives and to send them to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. The ones chosen were Judas, who was called Barsabas, and Silas, leaders among the brothers. This is the letter delivered by them. The apostles and the presbyters, your brothers, to the brothers in Antioch, Syria and Cilicia, of Gentile origin, greetings. Since we have heard that some of our number, who went out without any mandate from us, have upset you with their teachings and disturbed your peace of mind, we have with one accord decided to choose representatives and to send them to you, along with our beloved Barnabas and Paul, who have dedicated their lives to the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we are sending Judas and Silas, who will also convey the same message by word of mouth. It is the decision of the Holy Spirit and of us not to place on you any burden beyond its necessities, namely, to abstain from meat sacrificed to idols, from blood, from meat of strangled animals, and from a lawful marriage. If you keep free of this, you will be doing what is right. Farewell. And so they were sent on their journey. Upon their arrival in Antioch, they called the assembly together and delivered the letter. When the people read it, they were delighted with the expectation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will give you thanks among the peoples, O Lord.
I will give you thanks among the peoples, O Lord.
My heart is steadfast, O God. My heart is steadfast. I will sing and praise. Awake, O my soul, awake, fire and heart. I will awake the Lord.
I will give you thanks among the peoples, O Lord.
I will give thanks to you among the peoples, O Lord. I will chant your praise among the nations. For your mercy covers to the heavens, and your faithfulness to the skies. Be exalted above the heavens, O God. Above all the earth, be your glory.
I will give you thanks among the peoples, O Lord.
Let us all stand to name the Holy Gospel.
my commandment. Love one another as I love you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I no longer call you slaves, because a slave doesn't know what his master is doing. I have called you friends, because I have told you everything I have heard from the Father. It was not you who chose me, but I who chose you, and appointed you to go and bear fruit that will remain, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give you. This I command you, love one another. Brothers and sisters, the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Brothers and sisters in the Lord, participants in this catechetical leadership and supervision meeting or convention or information opportunity. I'd like to begin by thanking the LaSalle University for extending this service to the dioceses in the Philippines, especially in the service of catechetical leadership and supervision. You know that the summary of the content of catechetical instruction in Christian life is the Apostles' Creed. I remember one time there was a lady who approached me and who had a big problem to consult me about. She said, "Bishop, I have a problem because I cannot really recall the Apostles' Creed. My memory is fading," she said. She would usually pray the rosary, and you know the prayer of the rosary begins with the Apostles' Creed. She would say, "I believe in God, Father Almighty, and to you, my brothers and sisters." And then she would stop, you know, and she would say, "Something's wrong somewhere." Let's switch out from the creed to the quotidian. And I looked at her and I smiled and I said, "That's not really a big problem." I said, "If you forget the Apostles' Creed, just say the shortcut." And she was surprised. She said, "There is a shortcut?" I said, "Yes, yes, very simple. You just say, 'I believe in God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.'" Oh, she beamed, you know, and she was very happy. She says, "I think that's easier to remember." You see, instruction involves a lot of memorizing. If you know that the memory fails after some time, the wear and tear of age, you know, you challenge the memory. Even the clergy of San Fernando Pampanga had a problem with the Ten Commandments. If the focus of instruction for Christianity is the Apostles' Creed, for Judaism it was the Decalogue, Ten Commandments. I do remember many years ago, Archbishop Oscar Cruz gave a surprise quiz to the clergy of Pampanga. He was even bringing the blank sheets of paper and pencils with him. And he said, "I have a surprise quiz for you. I want you to list down the Ten Commandments, 1 to 10, in the right order." The priests were taken by surprise. Believe it or not, only 20 of 100 priests got them right. And the poor archbishop was disappointed. He says, "My goodness, imagine if you don't memorize the Ten Commandments, you say, okay, you'll be counting your fingers as well. It's the sixth commandment. And if you say, okay, next time you should not steal anymore, you're in trouble. But you know, the good thing is, the good news is, Jesus has summarized the commandments, you know, that. He has summed them up into two. Love God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. And he picks it up from the great Shema, Deuteronomy chapter 6. And then he appends it to Leviticus 19:18. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself. The so-called two loves. They were the favorite homily of the late Cardinal Saint. He says the two lines of the cross, the vertical and the horizontal. The two loves. The vertical love, love of God, love of God, and the horizontal love of neighbor as oneself. Kailangan mo ang memorize yan. Do you see? Even the two commandments are forgotten very quickly by people. And so today's gospel is really good news. Because Jesus says, my commandment to you is this, only this. Isa na lang. You know, from 10 to 2 to 1. Do you remember what it is? How is it again? That's not yet finished. Okay. He didn't say love one another. He said love one another as I have. That's the more important part of it. We do know how to love one another. You know, we do love one another somehow. But how to do it? Do you remember? Do you remember the poem of Elizabeth Barrett Browning? When we come to this, we do love, but how to love? How to love? Well, Jesus says, my commandment is this, to love one another as I have loved you. The criterion for love is Jesus. And that sums up the whole catechetical instruction. They know the context in which Jesus is saying this is the farewell address in the Gospel of John. You have a very long passion narrative in the Gospel of John. Remember, the Gospel of John is divided into two parts, the Book of Signs and the Book of Glory. The Book of Signs 1 to 12, the Book of Glory 13 to 21. And that's very long. That whole Book of Glory is already passion narrative. It begins with the Last Supper, the foot washing, chapter 13. What made it very, very long? Well, the farewell address. Jesus had his supper, Last Supper, with his disciples. And then, in the middle of that supper, he did something that shocked them. He washed their feet. And that is a task that is done only by the slaves. That is why Peter would not want his feet to be washed. Because he would not want to do it himself. And so Jesus gave a long speech telling them why he did he did to them. He said, do you understand what I, your Lord and Master, have done for you? You call me Lord. You call me teacher. You call me Master. He is the head catechist. Yes. What have I done to you? I have given you an example that you may do as I have done. That begins the speech. And I call it the last will and testament of Jesus. One of the most most beautiful compositions in the New Testament. Chapters 14, 15, 16, 17. Four chapters of the last will and testament of Jesus. It begins with his final instructions at the Last Supper. And the instruction began with a gesture. He did not begin with words. It began with a gesture. And what is that gesture? The gesture of a slave washing the feet of masters. And yet he's supposed to be the master. And then he says, what is this about? Well, what I have done to you is the summary of my instruction to you. I have given you an example so that you may do as I have done to you. This is not the task of a slave. It is the task of a friend. I no longer call you slaves. How can you continue to call yourselves slaves if the master has washed your feet? I am a slave with fellow slaves. I am a servant with fellow servants. And that makes us equal. We're friends. I no longer call you servants. Because a slave does not know what his master is about. Instead, I call you friends. It is an invitation to a relationship. And this is the most instructive part. The gesture. It presents very differently what Jesus said to James and John, sons of Zebedee, in Mark chapter 10, when they were trying to position themselves to his right and to his left. And Jesus said, you know how it is among the Gentiles. The authorities among them, they lord it over them. It shall not be so among you. The ones among you who are to lead must serve. That is why he introduced the vocabulary of servant leadership. Because in this world, leaders do not serve and servants do not lead. But Jesus put the two together. It's a paradoxical vocabulary, servant leadership. Yes, in the world of Jesus, in the kingdom of God, servants lead, leaders serve, servant leadership. Is what we are called to witness. I know Pope Francis says the homily must be much shorter, but it's not very often that I encounter catechists and supervisors of catechetical instruction. I thought of sharing you a little story about my mother. Many years ago, when my mother was still alive, she had a health crisis. She had a stroke that really disabled her. She had, you know, a clot in her cerebellum, and that destroyed her physical balance. She couldn't walk. She couldn't balance her body. And since we're 13 siblings, children, seven boys, six girls, we took turns looking after my mother. Actually, they did not want me to take a turn. But I said, alam din ako ni nanay, how come you would not put me in the schedule? I insisted, and they said, but you're teaching the seminary, you're very busy, how can you look after mother? I said, just give me a little schedule, preferably in the evening because I teach at daytime. And they said, "What light? Suit yourself." So they put me in schedule. What light? I was scheduled to look after my mother. And I was awakened by a movement. She was moving in bed. And I looked at her, she was trying to reach the alarm, meaning she needed a nurse. I got up and I said, "Mom, what's the matter? What do you need?" And she said, "Oh, it's nothing. Go back to bed. Go to sleep. It's okay." And then I pretended to go back to sleep, but I could hear her moving in bed and really trying to reach the alarm. I got up again and I said, "Mom, you need something? Why are you trying to reach the alarm?" And then she said, "I need to go to the corridor." I said, "It's okay, Mom. I can take care of that. Just call the nurse. She will help me." And I pressed the alarm. No response. And I went up to the nurse station. There was no nurse. They were probably making rounds. So I got back immediately. They said, "Ma, there's no nurse. Let me assist you." And she said, "How will you do it?" I said, "Ma, I just get a bed fan. You can do it with a bed fan." And she said, "No, why don't you help me get back? You know, I don't have balance, but you can assist me in a way that I can do it." She insisted, so I insisted her. She got up and she was playing. She was very heavy. I was able to assist her to climb it. And then the next problem, she had to put down her panties. She couldn't do it. So I said, "Mother, can you do it?" And I pulled down her panties, and then she sat down very quickly, you know, because she was very embarrassed. And that was it. She was relieved. We all got up. There's something wrong with the stomach. And then it was done. And then she said, "Call a nurse now, because the next thing is to wash her quick. Call a nurse now." I said, "Yeah, ma'am, just a moment." I pressed the alarm again, no response again. I ran out to the nurse station, no nurse again. I got back and I saw my mother already having a difficulty balancing her body. I said, "Ma, let me do it because there is no nurse." And she said, "No, no. Please, Ma, let me do it." "Why can't you use that hand for consecrating the body of Christ?" I said, "Ma, no big deal. You remember Jesus taught us to wash feet. What's the difference? Washing of the feet and washing of the foot?" She looked at me like, don't get smart with me. I said, "All right, Ma." And then I did it. I said, "Please, stoop down." I did. And I washed my mother's body. And then it was like utter humiliation for her. It's like an unthinkable thing. And when she got up again, sat straight again, I saw that there were tears in her eyes. And she looked into my eyes and she said, "Thank you. Thank you." I said, I felt my heart warm up inside. I said, "Ma, I only learned how to do it from you." It's like the experience brought me back to something I never saw myself that really happened when I was a baby. This moment of worship. Washed when I was a baby. Now is allowing herself to be washed. And what a privilege she was. Well, it was in a parallel sort of way, an instruction. We learn so much through this. Pope Paul VI says, nowadays, modern people prefer to listen to witnesses than to teachers. If they listen to teachers, it is because they are witnesses. It is the witnessing that matters the most. I'm preparing for another ordination in the diocese tomorrow, and I will be saying those very important words when the bishop hands the word of God to the ordinary. He will say, receive the word of God whose herald you now are. Believe what you read. Teach what you believe and practice what you teach. Beautiful instruction. Believe what you read. Don't just read. Take it to heart. Remember in Deuteronomy 6, take to heart the words that I enjoy. Don't just put them in your memory. Take them to heart. Believe what you read. Teach what you believe. Don't ever teach what you do not believe. Teach only what you're willing to die for. And most importantly, practice what you teach. That is what witness. Thank you for this privilege of blessing me here, catechetical leaders and senior pastors. You want to be truly effective, let us heed the call to rest. I have given you an example. And you what you need. So I have that. Christ calls us as friends and commands us to love one another. Let us show that love by the sincerity of our prayers. For every petition, let our response be, Lord, hear our prayer.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let those poems which you have put in the way, we proclaim the good news of God's love. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
By one another, in ensuring that humanly duty is respected and freedom is exercised. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
The married couples who take to heart our Lord's command to love one another, even in the most trying situations, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we who are gathered here we do our task with sincerity and eyes, and the people entrusted to us we nurture in love. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let the sick and the handicapped may find love in those who care for them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That God may grant eternal peace to our departed brethren. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
O Lord God, hear our prayers and let your love grow in us. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
these gifts, O Lord, we pray, and accepting the oblation of this spiritual sacrifice, make of us an eternal offering to you through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just. Our duty and our salvation at all times to acclaim you, O Lord. But in this time above all to love you, yet for glorious sake, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. He never ceases to offer himself for us, but defends us and ever pleads our cause before him. He is the sacrificial victim who dies no more, the lamb once slain who lives forever. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exalts in your praise, and even the heavenly powers, the angelic hosts, sing together the unending hymn of your glory. The mystery of faith.
Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them to the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her most chief spouse, with the blessed apostles, with Saint John the Baptist, the Messiah, and all the saints who have blessed you throughout the ages, we merit to be yours eternal life, and we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
And may your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.